For the majority of the time the NBA has been around, teams have felt that the only way to win and contend is to build through a big man. And when we think about the two most dominant big men of all time, Shaq and Wilt come to mind. Now today, I'm just going to look over the cases for why each of them can be called the most dominant center of all time. Shaquille O'Neal was a 7-foot, 300-pound monster. Throughout the majority of his career, he really had no one-on-one competition. Shaq was able to back down in the post and absolutely demolish anyone he went up against. So much so that the league had to change zone usage rules just to slow down Shaq. Now, throughout his career, he averaged 23 points per game, 10.9 rebounds, 2.5 assists, shooting 58% from the field and 52% from the line. Now, in his best year, Shaq averaged 29.7 points, 13.6 rebounds, 3.8 assists, shooting 57.4% from the field and 52% from the line. Now, from those numbers, you can see Shaq absolutely beasted on everybody. And throughout his playoff runs at the Lakers, nobody was able to stop Shaq. So this may make you wonder, how is Shaq only a one-time MVP? Well, this is the exact same thing that I wonder, and this is the exact same problem that a lot of people have with Shaq. Shaq was easily able to win way more MVPs, and he possibly could have won more championships in the 90s if it wasn't for Jordan and Hakeem. But he didn't. And this is probably because he just didn't put in 100% effort for some of his years. Now, let me give you an example of what I mean. When you take a test, you can get an A, right? You could get 97% on the test and get an A, or you could get 100% on the test and get an A. Which one's better? 100%. Yeah, you could say, yeah, there's still an A, but in this case, Shaq's lack of effort is the thing holding him back from arguably being greater than Wilt. Over Shaq's career, he was able to get 15 All-Star appearances, 2 scoring championships, 4 championships, 14 All-NBA appearances, 3 All-Defensive appearances, the Rookie of the Year, a 3-time Finals MVP, and a 1-time MVP. When we look at these accolades, what stands out is Shaq's longevity in the league. 14 All-NBA appearances shows how Shaq was able to stay good for a long period of time. And his 2 scoring championships and 3 Finals MVPs shows how dominant he really was on his teams. He was the best player on almost every team he played on. And 4 championships is absolutely amazing. His three-peat with the Lakers, where he arguably dominated the league better than anything we've ever seen before, is quite amazing, to be honest. But the one thing that also stands out about his resume is the fact that he only has 1 MVP, and that is always gonna kill Shaq. How can a player who was so dominant only be the most valuable player in the league for 1 year? Wilt Chamberlain was a 7'1", 275-pound monster. Now, Wilt Chamberlain holds most of the records in NBA history, and multiple rules have been changed just to stop Wilt from dominating. Now, although Wilt averaged incredible numbers in an area with inflated stats, the argument that Wilt didn't have competition is quite flawed. Now, what you have to remember, in Wilt's most dominant years, there were about 9 teams in the NBA. Now, think about it like this. If there are only 9 teams in the NBA, that means each of them would have had a dominant center, and in that era, 6 of them did, or at least 6 of them did. Some of the centers that Wilt would have been playing up against every night would have consisted of Walt Bellamy, Bill Russell, Willis Reed, Nate Thurmond. Like, the argument that Wilt didn't have competition is absurd. Every night, Wilt would have been playing against the best competition around. And one thing that people need to remember about that era is you're only as good as your competition. The game changes, rules change, different eras, but the same effort. And that's the one thing that people really need to realize about the 60s and the 50s and the 70s to an extent. Yes, of course, everything was different. And yes, you can say that they were playing against people who weren't as athletic as now. But that doesn't mean that the people of those eras weren't as great. And Wilt was great. Wilt was able to put up career averages of 30.1 points per game, 22.9 rebounds per game, 4.4 assists per game, shooting 54% from the field and 51% from the line. In his best year, the infamous 50-point year, Will averaged 50.4 points per game, 25 rebounds per game, 2.4 assists, shooting 50% from the field and 61% from the line. Now, inflated stats or not, those are incredible numbers. Wilt was incredibly dominant, and over Wilt's career, he was able to accumulate 13 All-Star appearances, 7 scoring championships, 2 championships, 10 All-NBA appearances, 2 All-Defensive appearances, a Rookie of the Year, 1 Finals MVP, and 4 MVPs. When looking at Wilt's resume, a few things stand out, just like Shaq's. Well, in fact, kind of the opposite of Shaq's. Wilt didn't win, and for somebody who is athletically gifted as Wilt, Wilt was arguably the most gifted athletic player in NBA history, in all of sports. Nobody has his speed, length, strength. How was Wilt stopped? That is the question that is going to put a dent in Wilt's career. Wilt should easily be a more than 2-time champion. He should easily be a more than 1-time finals MVP. But yet, he wasn't able to accomplish that feat. He allowed his obsession with personal statistics to hinder him from reaching the true goal, winning. In conclusion, I think both centers had incredibly dominant careers. Both acquired a lot of accolades, which could help their case for being the most dominant. But as a whole, I go with Wilt. Wilt was able to put up historical statistical numbers against the best competition of his time, night in and night out. Although Shaq was able to do the same, Shaq's lack of statistical accolades really hurt his argument for being the most dominant.